Return to Oz was released in 1985 and was a spin-off and sort of sequel to the original classic Wizard of Oz. Upon release, it got disastrous reviews from critics claiming it was too dark and scary for children, and it hugely affected the film's box office. Disney from the start weren't too keen on the director going with a more serious take instead of going with the musical approach. The movie was very costly and went over its original budget, costing around $20 to $25 million and only recouping about $11 million domestically. So it was a huge flop. Due to the financial failure of Return to Oz, it became increasingly difficult to track down on VHS during the 90s. It became out of print and Disney kind of wanted to sweep the film under the rug. The movie did prove very popular in Japan, I would imagine for its creative visual style, and was released a number of times on VHS and Laserdisc. It was also one of the first movies to be released in widescreen on the Laserdisc format. The film eventually turned up on DVD in the late 90s, but unfortunately the print used was not in the best of conditions. The movie is loosely based on the second and third Oz books, The Marvelous Land of Oz and Ozma of Oz. The element about TikTok being the royal army of Oz derives from the book TikTok of Oz. The director Walter Murch, who is well known in the industry for being one of the best sound designers and editors in the business and has also won 4 Oscars during his career, was approached by Disney in 1980 to direct the film. He and the writer Gil Dennis wrote a treatment and Disney were happy with the approach the director and writer were going with, and pre-production started, and I think during the next couple of years the director began going with a darker storyline than originally intended. The copyright on the books was coming to an end and Disney wanted to produce a feature soon before they lost the rights. Also, Murch took a decidedly darker take on the original source material than the 1939 original, which he knew starting out would be a gamble. Between the development period and actual shooting, there was a change of leadership at the Walt Disney Studios, and the movie's budget luckily increased. Once shooting began, Walter Murch began to fall behind schedule, and there was further pressure from the studio, leading to Murch being fired as director for a short period. George Lucas and other high-profile filmmakers, including Francis Ford Coppola, supported Murch in discussions with the studio, and Walter Murch was reinstated to finish the film. The film was made without the involvement of MGM, the studio that made the 1939 original. No approval was necessary because by 1985 the Oz books on which the film was based were in the public domain, and the subsequent Oz books had been optioned to Disney many years earlier. A large fee was paid, however, to use the ruby slippers, which was still the intellectual property of MGM at the time. The role of Dorothy went to newcomer Fairuza Balk. She had very limited acting experience, and for her age, she does a splendid job with the role and displays many emotions throughout the movie. She doesn't come across as annoying or wooden. Being at such a young age, I was surprised by the level of maturity she displays, and I would have thought they could have hired a slightly older actress, but she clearly gets away with it and makes a good impression. A highlight of the film is easily the Gnome King, played by Nicole Williamson, who is best remembered for his role as Merlin in Excalibur. He provides a fantastic performance and adds some genuine humour, and also can switch instantly into an evil bastard. The film takes place 6 months after Dorothy returns from the Land of Oz. She finds it very difficult to sleep, and she is obsessed with her memories of Oz. Her concerned Aunt Em and Uncle Henry, who don't believe her, are worried she cannot help them on the farm, which is at risk of foreclosure after the tornado. The two decide to take her to see Dr. Wally, known for his revolutionary electric healing treatments. While looking, hopefully, for any eggs laid by her favourite chicken, Belina, finds a key with the Oz logo, which she believes her friends from Oz sent to her the previous night by a shooting star. Aunt Em leaves Dorothy with Dr. Wally, under the strict care of Nurse Wilson, and she is taken to have treatment during the onset of a huge thunderstorm. The lab has a blackout and Dorothy is saved by a mysterious blonde girl who reveals that some patients have been driven insane by Wally's treatment and are hidden in the basement. The two escape the building with Nurse Wilson in pursuit and then fall into a river. The blonde girl vanishes underwater, but Dorothy survives by clambering on board a chicken coop. Upon awakening, Dorothy finds herself back in Oz with Belina, who can now talk. The two discover the ruined yellow brick road, which leads them to the Emerald City, now in ruins. Missing its emeralds and all of its citizens, including the Tin Woodman and Cowardly Lion, have turned to stone. Pursued by the Wheelers, Dorothy and Belina hide in a secret room using the key and meet a clockwork mechanical man called TikTok. Taking charge, TikTok explains that King Scarecrow is missing and has been captured by the Gnome King. When the three go to visit a head-exchanging witch named Mombi for more information, they end up imprisoned. While in prison, Dorothy, Bleena and TikTok meet Jack Pumpkinhead, a man made of three limbs with a pumpkin for a head. Jack refers to Dorothy as his mother since she resembles his own creator, and he reveals he was brought to life via Mombi's Powder of Life. The Gnome King has taken the Ruby Slippers and has destroyed the Land of Oz. The musical score to the movie has become one of my favourites. Composed by David Shire, he really brings across the sadness and also the happier side of Oz. The music does have that early 1900s style, and I feel it sounds similar in vein to John Barry's Somewhere in Time, which again is a very emotional and heartbreaking score. The soundtrack is not too hard to track down, many people have uploaded it to YouTube, and it's definitely worth a listen. The special effects were very impressive for the time, using great animatronics and puppets. The chicken especially is so well animated it looks real half the time. The map paintings are beautifully detailed, really giving a huge scope to the Land of Oz. There are a couple of dodgy blue screen shots, but they can easily be cleaned up if Disney made the effort. For the flying sequence where Dorothy escapes from Mombi, they use the Zoptic front projection technique pioneered on Superman the movie. It doesn't look as effective as it does in Superman. I think down to the characters are sitting on a couch, which is static, so you can't really do much with it in the frame. The movie incorporates the claymation technique, which for the most part looks really good. The Gnome King's minions, who travel through the rocks like they are passing through water, are animated beautifully, and the animators really help bring their characters across. At the end, when they surround Dorothy and her friends, the animation isn't as fluid as some of the other shots in the film, and the Gnome King is a little inconsistent in places, but mostly down to the time for the production schedule, which probably will affect the quality altogether. Claymation is such a time-consuming process and can't be rushed, but 80% of the claymation shots in the film are to a high standard. Film critics Siskel and Ebert both hated this movie and felt it was way too dark for children, but failed to highlight that the original Wizard of Oz scared many children as well when it was released. Siskel and Ebert even lumped this film into their worst of 1985 list.
The new film, Return to Oz, is not in the same league as the original. First, because it isn't a musical, and that was amazing that they made that decision. Second, because it doesn't star Judy Garland, of course they couldn't help that. Third, because it will terrify young children with its opening torture scenes. And fourth, because it rarely amazes us with any of its special effects. Other than that, it's routinely mediocre. Here's a scene where little Dorothy from Kansas, played by Firouza Balk, is in Oz, trying with some new friends to assemble another creature made by placing a moose head on a sofa. Boy, what those interior decorators in Oz won't think of next.
Go to the door and look out for Mommy.
All right, you Dorothy.
I like that guy. I like the Gnome King. And I got a suggestion for all the toy makers in America. I'm sure they're going to make little toys like the little Dorothy doll, yeah, a little sofa with the moose head. Gee, I really want my kid to have one of those. Give us the Gnome King in modeling clay so you can make your own Gnome King rather than just give us a flat Gnome King mask.
Hey, what a revolutionary idea. Modeling clay, the toy of the future.
Didn't you like modeling clay when you were growing up?
I mean,
you can do
really
great
pretty,
things
yeah.
with clay, like push it on
Here's
a wall.
Here's your Wizard of Oz toy, a block of clay. I mean,
and
that
you
will
make
really
it.
Go over well.
Well, all right, I'd buy it rather than the sofa. You probably like the moose head sofa. At any rate, I like all the rocks in Oz. They can open their little eyes, some of the rocks. I like how there's a whole wall of rock that's made to talk. But other than that, this movie looks like a set decorator's nightmare. Dorothy's new friends in Oz are not given fresh personalities. They're not played by interesting actors, all of which was the case, of course, in the original film. Gee, you got a broom handle with a pumpkin on it. That's real exciting. One last note of warning. I want to repeat just how terrifying the opening scenes of this movie are. This shocked me. Little Dorothy is strapped down in a bed like in an insane asylum, and she has electric treatments being threatened. She's threatened with those. I would imagine kids under six are going to get nightmares from this picture. Kids over six, they'll just have a bad time at the movies.
I agree. The first half hour, I thought I was looking at one of those Christopher Lee, Peter Cushing horror films, little girl strapped to the bed with a weird scientist performing experiments on it.
Strange.
Now I want to get to the claymation, the Gnome King, which you like. It was done by Will Vinton, who won an Academy Award using that process in a short study. It's well done.
Yes.
The Gnome King is based on one of the Oz books, so that's all fine. I think they based it on the wrong Oz book, because the magic of the original Wizard of Oz was the whole secret at the end, that you found out that the wizard was actually this little guy behind the curtain who was just as insecure as everybody else. Here, you have this giant, overwhelming, and apparently real monster, and to me, it loses the whole secret of Oz, which is that once you look behind the surface of things, you find out that they're not as bad as they
seem. Well, I got another suggestion, which is don't remake classic films. I know they didn't technically remake this, they did the extra books in the series, but don't even get near the classics, because we're all sitting there thinking it's not as good. Why go in with that? Someone once had a great line, Don't remake good pictures, remake bad pictures.
Okay, but if you're going to remake a picture, remake it in the spirit of the original. The original Wizard of Oz was a very innocent, very lighthearted and cheerful film. This movie seems more inspired by the more recent high-tech special effects thrillers, where you really, apparently kids, they think the kids these days are so overwhelmed with special effects that every movie has to be overkill. And this movie, to me, is too high-powered for little kids. You say six, I would say eight or nine are going to be overwhelmed by this picture.
I personally think Return to Oz is a beautifully crafted film with a lot of heart and emotion. Many of the emotional scenes are driven by the beautiful score by David Shire, which gives the movie its weight and makes it feel very classical. The world of Oz is fantastically imagined by production designer Norman Reynolds, and Walter Murch holds the film together surprisingly well, considering it's his first and only feature he directed. To many kids growing up, it was a very scary film in places, especially the introduction of the Wheelers, the Headless Mombi, and the Gnome King at the end when he turns into a giant rock monster and attempts to eat them. But many critics often criticise some films that are aimed at children for having scary elements, but in all honesty, kids like to be scared to a certain degree, and Oz does it to an acceptable level, and doesn't go too far with it. When there is a scary moment, it is often followed by a light-hearted comedic scene to balance it out. Making a sequel to a beloved classic and going with a serious approach and trying to stay faithful to the books is going to be tough. The original Wizard of Oz was a musical, and MGM at the time changed many things from the original books, but it's a film people grew up on and expect the same approach, and it's very difficult to change an audience perception of what a new film version or sequel should look and feel like. It's a shame Disney have not made an effort to really clean up the film and remaster it properly, because it's a visually stunning film that could look so much better if the video presentation was improved. Return to Oz is a movie that should never be forgotten, as it was after its release. Thanks to the internet, it's finally getting the respect it deserves, and hopefully Disney will make the effort to restore this film to its former glory.
Please,